is the ancestor's breath. When the fire's voice is heard, it is the ancestor's breath. In the voice of the waters, those who have died have never, never left. The dead have a pact with the living. They are in the woman's breast. They are in the waiting child. They are with us in the home. They are with us in the ground. The dead have a pact with the living.
Good afternoon, and thank you for flying Air International, flight number 103.1 FM. I'm your pilot, April Snell, and this is a place where you're sure to fly first class every time you fly. Ask me why it's first class? It's the passengers, and today we have Michelle Lanier. She'll be talking to us about how narrative, storytelling, and folklore serves for transcendence peace. This semester on Air International, we will be looking through the lens of peace builder John Paul Lederach and how he uses narrative agency, discourse, conflict, storytelling, and folklore as a means for transformative peace. Today we have Michelle Lanier. She received her undergraduate degree from Spelman College under the renowned Dr. Johnnetta B. Cole, her graduate degree in folklore with an emphasis on African diaspora and Black Southern life was attained at UNC-Chapel Hill. Her career in cultural heritage preservation began with community-based work in Orange, Durham, and Alamance counties. Michelle's work has taken her to Panama and Ghana to document African diaspora funerary traditions, and her ethnographic work in a Carolina Gullah community led to her role as a liaison to the Gullah Geechee Cultural Heritage Corridor. Michelle continues to use her background as a folklorist, public historian, documentary educator, oral historian, and cultural preservationist. Jean-Paul Lederach, practitioner and theorist of peacebuilding, has grounded his work in stories and metaphor. Like a poet, he makes connections with fields and disciplines that are not normally connected in the literature of peacebuilding, and he does so with the realism of a practitioner. In doing some research on Michelle Lanier, a word that kept coming up was eclectic. As an adjective deriving ideas, styles, or taste from a broad and diverse range of sources. The synonyms: wide-ranging, broad-based, extensive, and comprehensive. From the philosophical point of view, denoting or belonging to a class of ancient philosophers who did not belong to or found any recognized school of thought, but selected such doctrines as they wished from various schools. So thank you for coming today, Michelle.
Thank you for having me, April.
It's great to have you here. So one of the questions that I want to ask you is, where did you get your inspiration from?
I'm so glad that you asked me about my inspiration, because just sitting here with you on this flight is such a gift. And when I come to you and your listeners, I do not come alone. I come with all of the men and women before me who paved the road for me to be here, particularly some of the ancestors of my own family that inspire me. I'm thinking in particular of my maternal grandmother, Anne Grace Richardson Caution, and she was born in Goldsboro, North Carolina. She was a woman who they said was born outside of generation. And what I mean by that is she was really the only little one in her grandparents' house at the time that she was a child, because of the way that she, the time period that she was born in. So she didn't have siblings. She was the only child. And she also didn't have little cousins running around. So what that meant was she heard a lot of grown folks' conversation. And she carried inside of her the memories of our people. And the way that she poured story over her progeny, including myself, was with great love and passion. And I felt with a great commitment to teach us stories of dignity, stories of resilience, stories of creativity, and fortitude. And so she is one of the most important inspirations in my journey and in my work.
Okay. In reading John Paul Lederach's works, he uses, as well as you, folklore and healing theory. And I'm referring to his book, When Blood and Bones Cry Out. How do you use folklore to heal when working and building with community? How does that lend to the healing process?
So it's really interesting. A lot of times when I tell people that I'm a folklorist, there's confusion about what that actually means. Many people think that that means I'm a storyteller, that I tell folk tales. Some people think that it means that I document folk tales, and that actually is not what I do. Folklore, the way that I studied it in my graduate studies, is in the tradition of Zora Neale Hurston and in the tradition of another shero of mine, Anna Julia Cooper, who was a part of the founding membership of the Hampton Institute Folklore Society. And so what we do as folklorists, first of all, we all work in different ways, but the way I work is to really bear witness to the cultural expressions of a people, of any community. And by cultural expressions, yes, it can be folk tales, but it can also be food ways, how people decorate their homes, what people sing when they are mourning or celebrating. So definitely music. It is the aesthetics of a people. What do you put on your body at different times of the year and for different celebrations? What is your linguistic tradition? And so I have done work particularly around Gullah community in the coasts of North Carolina and South Carolina. And there are Gullah community legacies all over the world, but the historical geography of Gullah goes from North Carolina in the Wilmington area all the way down to northern Florida. So I've done this work in those communities, but also African diaspora communities in Ghana, as well as Panama, and in what I call Afro-Carolinian landscapes. So not just on the coast, but the Piedmont, the West, people of African descent in the Carolinas, that's part of my passion. But I could do a folklore project on a group of CEOs in corporate America. I could do a folklore project on a group of hip hop, you know, skateboarders in a suburban community, because anytime there's a cultural group, there are cultural practices. And so one of the primary tools that I use to bear witness to the worldview, the aesthetic, the practices, the traditions, the language, the material culture of any community is through the exchange of human narrative, is to sit and really listen to people talk about who they are individually and collectively and how they are. And sometimes I call that oral history. Sometimes I call that documentary work. Sometimes I call that ethnography. And for me, there was a moment in my journey that I think is very pertinent to your question that I want to share. I was in graduate school for folklore, and I had a vision of what that journey was going to be like. My vision was that I would get the master's degree in folklore, really continuing to look at Gullah community. And then I would identify a doctoral program and maybe another different but similar field. And that I would just make my way through the academic path. So at that time, I was in the Triangle area around Carrboro and Chapel Hill. And I noticed an upheaval and a cultural collision that made me pay attention. At that time in the 90s, there was an ever-increasing number of Latinx people, Spanish-speaking people who were being, you know, pulled, drawn to work opportunities, particularly in fields and factories, generally because of a lack of opportunities in their own homelands or trying to reunite with family. At the same time, there was this kind of mythology that was happening where certain Black and white Southerners were marking these folks as being somehow a threat to the economy of their own well-being. You would hear conversations where you might hear a Black person say, these folks are coming in to take our jobs, or you might hear it from a white person as well. And so there was a racial conflict that was palpable, and it hurt me to hear people of African descent talk in these ways about people from Central South America and then North America and Mexico, to talk about these folks as if we as Black folks haven't been marginalized or been in a place where we would do absolutely anything to take care of ourselves and our families, so that there wasn't a sense of solidarity. It was heartbreaking for me. I got it. I understood that it was fear-based, but it was heartbreaking. And in that moment, I understood that everything that I had been learning around the ethics and best practices of ethnography and oral history had grown my heart and had grown my empathy for humankind and had revealed to me the power of sharing human narrative as a powerful tool for connecting people from different backgrounds. That when we bear witness to someone from a different background, that we may have been prejudicial toward that person in that person's communities, and maybe even bigoted. When you hear their story and you connect with their story and they hear your story, there is a tie that binds the two of you in a new way. And it becomes harder to be prejudicial, bigoted, or even oppressive toward people that you then have a bond with, yeah, that you then see as human. And so I had an awakening and an awareness that I was not being called to walk a conventional path in the academy, that in fact my gifts were being called to disrupt and dismantle some of the divisions between people and some of the fear-based thinking through the power of the exchange of personal experience. So what I did was I partnered with another folklorist who had similar values, a white woman who had roots in the mountains. Her people had known great socioeconomic insecurity because of being coal mining family. My family had been educated for generations, and here I was a Black woman for the South. And so both of us kind of made problematic the stereotypes of what it meant to be a white woman of the South and a Black woman of the South. Just in our mere genealogies, we ran counter to the stereotype. Mm-hmm. And getting to know each other was a powerful experience. And so we wanted to share that. We attained a generous seed grant from a foundation. I was pregnant with my daughter at the time. And we created a program called Creating Connection. And the idea was to get young people to start with the youth, because when you bring children to the center of a project around conflict resolution and bridging communities that are traditionally divided, it is a beautiful strategy, because you cannot bring children to the center without bringing their family. Generally, that means the elders come too. Mm-hmm. And generally, the children take back to the elders what they have learned. And generally, the children hold their teachers and elders accountable in new ways. And not only that, but then if those children then go on to influence other children as they grow older, you then influence future generations through those children. So through children, we can reach back and grab elders, and we can reach forward and grab hold in a loving way of future generations. And so what these children did, they were partnered across identity lines. So you'd have a Black child with a white child. You'd have a Jewish child with a Latinx child. You'd have a Christian child with a Jewish child. And they would be all paired together in twos, and they had assignments. They had to interview each other to learn about each other. So that was beautiful, because we had a cross-cultural relationship developing of respect, empathy, compassion, and witness. But then they had a second assignment, which is to take turns going to interview an elder from the other's community. So you'd have, you know, the Jewish child and the Christian child going to interview an elder in the Christian community and an elder in the Jewish community. And so then we had a intergenerational aspect of it. And what we found is the children from the same community as the elder were hearing stories that they hadn't heard before, and they were also positioning themselves in a posture of pride and respect because they were showing off their elder to the other child. And so from that, we were able to get the children to create poetry, hip-hop songs, spoken word, to bring new voice to the stories that they had had a chance to record. And that was an opportunity to take the tools of folklore, ethnography as a practice and apply it to real world divisions between communities. That really was one of the beginnings of my journey and my work. That was almost 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm. And it sounds so fresh.
Yes, it was almost 20 years ago, and it's still with me.
While reading about you, you had did an interview with NPR. And you talked about Beyonce making lemonade out of lemons. And there was something that, while reading about you, and I came across a segment from NPR where you were talking about Beyonce's making lemonade out of lemons. And you talked about how the revolution for women looks different from the 60s, and that there was a reconciliation, and that word resonated with me, reconciliation. Now, can you tell us the difference that you're seeing between the revolution of the 60s and now the revolution in the 2017-1800s?
Sure. So lemonade is definitely, I think, a lightning rod album for many people. Beyonce is a lightning rod person for many people. There are some people who are still trying to feel comfortable with her for many reasons. I am one of the people who lean deeply into her journey and take a lot of inspiration from it. Lemonade in particular is not just for me an album and a collection of art films, but it is also a text that can be read in a number of ways. In particular, I feel like it's important to call out the beautiful, heartfelt, and at times heartbreaking poetry of Worsaw Shire, and her poetry takes certainly center stage in Lemonade, the album. And when we hear about the girls raising their hand and you know, I tried to make a home out of you. These certain phrases that we hear throughout the visual album Lemonade that come from Worsaw Shire. One of the things that I love about this example of what I will call multivocality is that we see in Lemonade this collective of voices. It's not a singular Beyonce voice. We also see it in the imagery of the visual album, that there are these moments where Black women are standing together across the spectrum of every possible color that a Black woman could be, every possible shape and generation. And there's a kind of power in that solidarity. We hear that heartbreak is a part of every Black woman's journey, but also reconciliation, rebirth, revival, renewal, rage. All of that is a part of not only the grief process, but a reclamation of voice. And so rather than seeing it as so distinctly different than the womanist movement of the 60s, I would say it's an expansion of. We needed the work of the 1960s and 1860s and 1930s in terms of Black women's liberation movements, women of color's liberation movements, women of all ethnicities' liberation movements. And I think like anything that has love and liberation at the center of it, it grows. I think that we can analytically and theoretically say, oh, here's this distinct movement and here is how it is categorically different or contrasted to another movement. I am more so of the mindset and ethos that we see how do they build upon each other, dance with each other, collide. So for me, this notion of the femme story that I'm seeing a lot of in social media, where we see trans women being pulled in, so that the femme movement putting on you know, clothing or makeup or doing one's hair in a way that is exciting or deemed attractive, that that is, does not mean that that person is not a feminist. And let me speak in the affirmative, that it is possible to be invested in how your hair looks, what kind of outfit you have on, in fashion, and still be feminist or womanist. And so that's something that I'm seeing crack open in a new way with today's women's liberation movements. So I would say if I would, what's distinct to me, well, certainly social media. We didn't have that in the 1960s, but we also didn't have this language around trans women and, you know, this notion of being femme. Or butch women also being a part of that story, and that the complexities of what it means to be woman has been just exploded. I find it exhilarating, sometimes confusing, exciting. Yes. This has taken me back to a position of being a student again. I find that I need to turn to my daughter and say, "Tell me about this language. What does cisgender mean? What, you know, to help me understand what is femme, what is trans? Help me to understand." The notion of being able to declare pronouns for oneself, being able to say I'm a they instead of her or him. So all of this new language, all of these new concepts of gender have just exploded in, I think, beautiful ways. And so that's very exciting to me. And I love that all of these newly, these are not new realities. It says in the Bible, there's nothing new under the sun. It's not new realities, but they're new expressions. They're expanded expressions. And so it's exciting to me to see how these newly expanded expressions of women's liberation can be used towards dismantling hegemonies of oppression. It's like, yes, if there are more tools in our toolbox that allow us to shake the shackles off, bring it. If it makes us bigger and bolder and stronger. And that is something I feel at the heart of Lemonade. When you see those women in the trees sitting and looking across the land or standing on the stage looking out in their white Victorian dresses, and they're not being, they're not confined by the lace. They are regal. They are powerful. They're wearing their crowns. And I feel like they're calling us to wear ours too.
So you've just said a lot, and ultimately we're getting ready to land.
Okay.
So ultimately, what would you have our listeners know about the power of narrative?
Words are powerful. Depending on your faith tradition, you believe that words created the universe. You believe that words continue to change the universe. And so even the words we think, the words we read, the words we see, the words we hear, the words we say, everything changes. Every single word that we think, hear, say, and see changes the universe. And so that is first and foremost the foundation of understanding how extraordinary it is to share your own story with others and to have others share their story with you, because things shift. We are never the same upon hearing someone else's story. Forever the person's story is in our bones.
That is powerful.
We are forever transformed. And if people are interested in how do we lean into the current world that is in a state of upheaval, if you are overwhelmed by a spirit of hopelessness or fear because of the very volatile climate that we live in right now, all you have to do is start with the person next to you and listen.
Thank you, Michelle. Thank you so much for coming today. And like I said, Air International is a place where you fly first class, and our passengers are those who make it a first-class flight. And this interview today has reconnected me and has uplifted me. Thank you so much for coming today. and I'm sure we'll see each other in the very near future.
It's been a blessing. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm gonna go to the hospital.